morning.
Morning. Morning.
Welcome to St. Stephen's. Welcome to all of you who are here. Welcome to all of you joining us through live stream. It is great to have all of you with us. We have a lot of announcements, a lot of exciting news today. First and foremost, you know what? I think we're going to talk about the organ first. I think that's a big thing because the new organ is here, of course. It came on Tuesday. We were so excited. If you have not seen the pictures on Facebook about the moving in of the organ, it's pretty impressive to see it. I've been joking. It's like watching the Ark of the Covenant come forth. So it's been pretty impressive. I know Leo has some good news. So Leo, co-chair of our organ fund, he's got visual aids, I think.
I guess so.
That'll be
a show and tell. James, could you give me mine too?
Happy day. We don't do a lot of gospel at St. Stephen's, but it really is a happy day. And I know that I'll try and be brief because you probably want to hear more from James and from me. But it was a great campaign. We really only went public 2 weeks ago, May 2nd, and we started, of course, with a great foundational grant from the North Dakota Episcopal Foundation, which John Baird engineered for us. And from there, it just took off. And so just to remind you, the cost of the new organ was $22,217. And then we were told that we needed, well, we knew because it came with the organ, the bid, that we needed a dedicated electrical circuit to implement the warranty. And then we had an electrician come, Brian Gelinske had someone come, and he said, well, depends on what I have to do and downstairs and so forth. It could be as much as $1,500. So, and it turned out not to be that much. But we raised our goal to $23,017. And because we wanted to be able to pay for the electricity. But as of today, our total is
$23,840. Wow.
So, and you have in your leaflet all the very generous donors. I counted 36, just incredibly, incredibly generous donations. 500, 1,500. Two people gave their stimulus checks, 1,400. It was really just an outpouring of support. And I think James should tell us something that about the new organ, things he's surprised by, things he's really delighted by.
It's a completely different instrument than what we've had. Not only does it work differently because it has 20 years younger technology, but it does things that you'll hear out here. For example, on a real pipe organ, it doesn't just shut the volume down. There are little shades on the box that close shut. And also what that happens is the organ gets less bright. So if you put your hands up in front of your mouth, and then you're talking, regardless of how loud you get in here, it's less bright than when the windows open up and then the brightness comes. So you'll hear a lot of that. It's like, oh, that kind of sounds kind of dull there. And then it'll suddenly brighten up. And that's just, there are lots of things that on it that are much more like how a pipe organ works. You'll notice in the back, the old speakers are gone. And two smaller speakers are in. They're designed just for this organ. Brian Gelinske has graciously volunteered to come in and remove the top shelf, which is going to require, it is so well mounted, it's going to require an impact drill to remove. So any people that work with us know that that's when you're pulling out the big guns. And so the speakers will eventually stand up, not by themselves, we'll stand them up, but don't know what they do when I'm not
here.
Well,
they stand up on their own. That's pretty amazing. I don't know, how much did we pay for that? They stand up on their own.
There are lots of things on it that I'll have to get used to. One is how I hear you, all of you, differently because I don't have an unbalanced organ. The organ is actually balanced so that if you stand right here, you can't tell whether the sound is coming from the front or the back. And then as you move towards the back, it sounds more like it's coming from the back. So that's going to take me several weeks to learn how it works in here with people in it, because it sounds different this morning than when we had fewer people in. So you'll have to be, I ask you to be a little patient and give me feedback. There are a couple spots I've noticed that it's really loud, and we'll try to get that adjusted down, because I can go in and adjust even individual sounds or even individual notes of individual sounds. So over time, we can really make it our organ. And thank you to everybody who came and moved it in. I've never broken a bottle of champagne over anything. I did smell like I was, it came straight back at me, the bottle, not the bottle, the contents. So I all afternoon when I was playing on it, I occasionally, it's like I was in a cheap lounge act.
Well, actually, there's a fine line.
But you know, like you'll hear different things. Like you heard the oboe and flute beforehand. That wasn't, the oboe and flute were not organ stops. They're sampled from somebody that was actually playing in an orchestra. So you'll hear different things at different times. The key thing to remember about it, though, is the only reason we have an organ in the liturgical church is to aid in singing and to support you in your singing, because it's the congregation's song that is what Michelle and I and the other musicians help lead you in. We just are a little bit more noticed. And it will take a while for our ears to settle in. So, yeah, it's going to be lots of fun. Thank you to Jamie for championing music and for Leo and Annette for chairing it. When they said, oh, it's going to be here in a couple weeks, I was like, a couple weeks in September? They're like, no, it's going to be here in a couple weeks. And that's just testament to the importance of music to this parish.
Well, and that's, James is so correct on that. I mean, we get these projects, and I think about the last couple of major projects we've had, and it's amazing how quickly it has all come together. I think about our stained glass windows, which we thought was going to be, it was going to take us 10 years to put all these windows in, and they came in just under 2 years. Our labyrinth last summer when we had our labyrinth renovation, and now the organ, and Leo, you did a you and Annette did a great job on that. So thank you for everybody who helped out with this. It was incredible. And the celebration isn't over yet, of course, because this coming Wednesday, Bishop Tom Ely will be making his first visit here to St. Stephen's at our 6 o'clock Mass. So he will be dedicating and blessing the organ. So it will be a wonderful night. That night we have some confirmations and receptions that night as well. It's going to be kind of a crazy, amazing night. We're going to have a reception out in the parking lot afterward with lemonade and cupcakes and all of those kind of fun things. So that will be happening at 6 o'clock on Wednesday, the 19th of May. Let's see, what else is going on? Well, a lot has been going on. Of course, you did hear about the CDC this changing their mask guidelines. We are still, as of right now, still following our old protocols, but new protocols, revised protocols, will be going out this afternoon. I just want to get some feedback from the vestry before I send that out this afternoon. So that will be happening this afternoon. I'm not going to even give you a sneak peek of that yet. Let's see. Looking ahead just down the road, the 26th of May. On the 26th of May, we will be rededicating and blessing our Celtic cross. It will be the eve of the 50th anniversary of when that cross was put in. Clotine and Stuart Freer had that dedicated in memory of Stuart's mother. And so I'm using that as a catalyst for starting a Celtic Rite Mass that we will be doing on Wednesday nights throughout the summer. So we'll have kind of a Celtic night on the 26th of May. I know you expect that in March on St. Patrick's Day, but you'll get it at the end of May because, you know, Celtic countries, it's Celtic time all the time. So so we'll be doing that on the 26th. Looking ahead just down the road a ways, June 20th, we will be celebrating Deacon John Anderson's first anniversary of ordination to the diaconate. Since it happened during COVID, so many of us, none of us were really able to celebrate except for our little core group of people. And so we will be celebrating John Anderson's ordination on the 20th of June. That is a Sunday morning, of course, and we will have a reception for him afterward. We've got some gifts for him. So if anybody has any gifts that they didn't give him last year, this would be a great opportunity to do so and just celebrate diaconal ministry here at St. Stephen's. I think that's it. Anything else that I might be missing? If not, if you'll please stand, we will begin. We'll begin. That was it. I thought someone was raising their hand. They were not. Please stand. Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Almighty Almighty God,
to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Exalted your only Son, Jesus Christ, with great triumph to your kingdom in heaven. Do not leave us comfortless, but send your Holy Spirit to strengthen us and exalt us to that place where our Savior Christ has gone before, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for our lessons.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers, together the crowd numbered about 120 persons, and said, "Friends, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit through David foretold concerning Judas, who became a guide for those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us and was allotted to share in this ministry. So one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us, one of those must become a witness with us to the resurrection." So they proposed two: Joseph, called Barsabbas, who was also known as Justice, and Matthias. Then they prayed and said, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place. And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell to Matthias, and he was added to the 11 apostles. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of John. If we receive human testimony, the testimony of God is greater, for this is the testimony of God, that he has testified to his Son. Those who believe in the Son of God have the testimony in their hearts. Those who do not believe in God have made him a liar by not believing in the testimony that God has given concerning his Son. And this is the testimony. God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Let us now stand for the reading of the Gospel.
Alleluia, alleluia.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus prayed for his disciples, saying, I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave to me I have given to them, and they have received them and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I'm asking on their behalfs. I'm not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them in your name that you have given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost except the one destined to be lost, so that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and I speak these things in the world, so that they may have my joy made complete in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, so that they may also be sanctified in truth. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Well, as I mentioned in the announcement today, of course, on Thursday, the CDC, of course, essentially lifted the mask mandate. As I said, I will be releasing updated protocols after asking for some feedback from our vestry today. But it's a lot of people are feeling very optimistic with that announcement. And we too are feeling somewhat cautiously optimistic about our future. And as I've been saying for several weeks, we need to start thinking honestly and seriously about moving into this sort of post-pandemic mode. It's a strange thing to even be thinking of because we've lived with this for so long. But what we find ourselves in then is we find ourselves in a bit of a plateau right now. That's what it feels like. We're not quite in all the thick of all the pandemic stuff, but we're not quite in this post-pandemic mode quite yet. We're in a flat open space between where we have been and where we are going. So what does that mean? How do we even live in this strange purgatory, so to speak? What does the post-pandemic world, and most specifically the post-pandemic St. Stephen's, look like? What are we even looking toward? Well, I'll be honest with you, I don't know. None of us really do at this point. I'm not a prophet. Well, kind of a prophet. We're all kind of prophets, but not quite that prophet. Not a fortune teller. But I do know that just as somehow we got through the darkest days of the pandemic, so we continue to move forward and do what we're called to do even then in the future in the wake of the pandemic. When these things happen, when bad stuff or times of major change happens, I usually say this, and you've heard me say this many, many times. Look at how the Spirit moves in our midst in these particular times. Now, I do believe that we are finding ourselves moving into a place, yet again, that is very similar to the place those first followers of Jesus were in right about now in their following of Jesus, just after Jesus ascended into heaven. They are being prepared for the movement of the Spirit of God in their lives to a large extent. Now, this week in our scripture readings, we move slowly from the Easter season toward Pentecost. For the last several weeks, we've been sort of basking in the afterglow of the resurrected Jesus. In our gospel readings, we've seen the resurrected Jesus walking with us, talking with us, eating with us, and he's led the way for us in our scripture readings. Now, as of last Thursday anyway, he's been taken up into heaven with the ascension. Now, we find a transformation of sorts happening. With his ascension, our perception of Jesus, we find, has kind of changed a bit. No longer is he this wise sage, the misunderstood rebel, the religious renegade that he seemed to be when he walked around on the earth anyway, performing miracles and upsetting the religious and political powers that be. He now becomes something much more. He's more than just a regular prophet. He's the prophet extraordinaire. He's the fulfillment of all prophecies to some extent. He's more than just a king, despotic monarch like Caesar or Herod. He is now truly the Messiah. He is the divine Son of God. At his ascension, we find that he is, in a sense, anointed, crowned, and ordained. He does not just ascend back to heaven and then is sort of dissolved into the great unknown. He ascends and then assumes this place at the right hand of God. At his ascension, we find that what we are gazing at is something that we couldn't comprehend before. If somebody had told any of us, if we were living at that time, that things like this were going to happen, we would have laughed at them. At his ascension, we find that what we are gazing at really is something amazing. He has helped us to see that God has truly come among us. He has reminded us that God has taken a step toward us. He has shown us that God truly loves us and truly cares for us. He has shown us that the hold death held is now broken. He has reminded us that God speaks to us not in pillars of cloud or in fire, not on some shroud-covered mountain, not in visions, but God is with us and speaks in us. So yes, I guess we are God's prophets right now. The puzzle pieces of this whole mystery fall into place. What seemed so confusing and so unreal is finally starting to come together. God truly does love us and know us. And next week, on the Feast of Pentecost, on our Pentecost Sunday, that one more puzzle piece falls into place. Next week, we will celebrate God's Spirit, the Spirit of God descending upon us and staying with us. Now, for the moment, as I said, we are in this weird plateau, caught between these two events, the Ascension and Pentecost, trying to make sense of what happened and trying to prepare ourselves for what is about to happen. But things really are about to change. Man, are things about to change. We are caught between Jesus' ascent into heaven and the Spirit's descent to us. So in that sense, when we realize that, when we look at that reality, we realize that plateaus are not necessarily a bad thing. A plateau offers us a time to pause, to ponder who we are and where we are in this place, in this time, in which everything seems so topsy-turvy. In this time before the Spirit moves and stirs up something incredible. This week, smack dab in the middle of the 12 days between the Ascension and Pentecost, we find ourselves examining the impact of this event of God in our lives. And God has made an impact in our lives. The commission that the ascended Jesus gave to those apostles is still very much our commission as well. And what is that commission? Of course, it's to love, love fully and completely. I know it's another sermon about love, I'm sorry. But in loving, we are living. In loving, we are bringing the ascended Christ to others. And we must go out and live out that commission in this world. When we do, the ascended Christ is very much acting still in this world. When we think about what those first followers went through in a very fairly short period of time, Jesus' betrayal and murder, his resurrection and his ascension, we realize that this must have been an amazingly life-altering experience for them. Their lives, their faith, their whole sense of being and purpose were changed forever. they would never be who they were before. This is where we are right now as well, right here in this plateau in the pandemic. We find ourselves simply moving through these life-altering events with sort of bated breath. Only later, maybe when everything has all settled down, will we have the opportunity to examine what has just happened to us. Because something major just happened to all of us. And it is then that we realize the enormity of the changes that have come upon our lives. Now, for those first followers of Jesus, it seems like they didn't have much of a chance to ponder these life-giving experiences. As soon as one life-altering experience happened, there was another one that came along. Just when they experienced Jesus' death, resurrection, and ascension, they encountered this outpouring of God's Spirit in their lives. The waters, it seemed, were kept perpetually stirred. Nothing was allowed to settle. That is what our ministry is often like. One day, very early in my career as a priest, I came to that realization myself. I think Deacon John probably came to that realization fairly early on as well. Ministry is perpetually ongoing. There's no ending to it. It's always something. One week brings just another set of opportunities, setbacks, trip-ups, tediums, frustrations, joys, celebration, the whole range of experiences. These are the things those first followers of Jesus no doubt struggled with. Yet, like them, somehow we are sustained. We, like them, are upheld. We, like them, are supported by the God who welcomed the ascended Jesus, whose work that we are doing now in this world. In those moments when our works seem useless, when it seems like we have done no good in this world, the God who brought Jesus back still triumphs. Now, we all remember that song by the Beatles. I know Deacon John knows this song, Eleanor Rigby. One of my favorite songs. Do you like Eleanor Rigby?
Yeah.
You're not real enthusiastic about that. Yeah, I love it.
More of a Rolling Stones guy than a Beatles.
Oh, okay. Well, that explains a lot. All right. Eleanor Rigby, one of my favorite songs by the Beatles, though. And I remember how, when I would listen to that song, how sad I was when, at the end of it, you heard them sing about Father Mackenzie and how he wipes the dirt from his hands as he walks from the grave. No one was saved. No one was saved. How horrible. That was so bleak and ugly. But you know what? That's what it feels like sometimes. But those moments are moments essentially of our self-centeredness. Those moments are moments when we think that it all depends on us, on me. Our job in this time between Jesus' departure from us and the return of the Holy Spirit to us, in this post-pandemic era that we are about to be entering, is to simply let God do what God needs to do in the interim. We need to let the Holy Spirit work in and through us. We need to let the God who brought Jesus to heaven be the end result of our work. When we wipe our hands as we walk from the grave, whatever that might be, lamenting the fact that it seems like no one was saved, we need to realize that, of course, it seems that way when we are gazing downward at our hands. But above us, if we look up, the ascension is happening. Above us, Jesus, seated at God's right hand, is triumphant. As prophet of prophets, as king of kings, as the high priest of all priests. Above us, in that place of glory with God, Jesus triumphs, and we with him. Above us, God's Spirit is about to rain down upon us as flames of fire. But all we have to do is just look up. Look away from our self-centeredness and look to God. All we have to do is stop gazing at our dirty, calloused, overworked hands. All that we have to do is turn from our own self-centeredness and look up. And there we will see the triumph. And as we do, we will realize that more were saved than we initially thought. Someone really was saved. We were saved. Jesus has ascended, and we or will ascend with him as well. He prays in today's gospel that we may have his joy made complete in ourselves. That joy comes when we let the Holy Spirit be reflected in what we do in this world. So let the Spirit of joy be truly complete in you. Let the spirit of joy live in you and through you and be reflected by you. When we do, we will be, as Jesus promises us, sanctified in truth. We will be sanctified in the truth of knowing and living out our lives in the light of salvation. Loving God, we rejoice today in the fact that you have brought your Son Jesus to be seated at your right hand. Prepare us as we wander about in this plateau in our lives so we can truly receive your Spirit and all the gifts that come with Pentecost. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us now stand and affirm our faith. Words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally God the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not by any. Of one being with the Father, through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified in Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven. And is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
As we wait for the Holy Spirit to come, let us pray for all who thirst and desire the water of life, saying, hear our prayer.
Hear our prayer.
For all the holy people of God in every place, for Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, and the Anglican Church in Korea, for Michael, our presiding bishop, for the Episcopal Diocese of Eastern Michigan, for Bishop Tom and the Episcopal Diocese of North Dakota, for All Saints, Valley City, and the Diocesan Haiti Mission Project, and for all who minister in Christ, and for all your holy people, God of glory. For this holy gathering, and all who enter our circle of faith, for Jamie, our priest, for myself, your deacon, for our wardens, John and Jessica, and for our vestry, and for all our ministries, that we may embody your love and acceptance of all people and continue to be a place of refuge for those who seek you and for those who cannot be here at this time to share in your Son's body and blood, but who join us at this altar in your spirit. We pray today especially for Heather Riley, Christine and Steve Rarick, Amy Phillips and Dan Rice, Justin Rudnick, that we may continue to be a place where all people may be fully accepted, fully loved, and fully included. God of glory. For Andrew, Conrad, Kevin, and Leonard, who are to be confirmed or received into the Episcopal Church this Wednesday evening, God of glory. For Joe, our president, and for our nation and its people, and especially for those who guard the peace of the world and work against injustice and oppression, God of glory. For the cities of Fargo, Moorhead, and West Fargo, and the communities around us, God of glory. For all those who have graduated and for those who are graduating, especially Siri Froiland, God of glory. For all who are in any pain, who are sick, or who sorrow, we pray today especially for Josh, David, Annette, Deanna, Bruce, Darla. God of glory,
hear our prayer.
For those who are neglected, who are lonely and forgotten, for the strayed and the lost, and for all those in special need, this morning we pray especially for Mignon and Kristen. God of glory,
hear our prayer.
For ourselves, our families, and those we love, and for our own intentions repeated either silently or aloud, I invite you now to share those. God of glory,
hear our prayer.
For the victims of violence in this country, God of glory,
hear our prayer.
For those who have fallen asleep in Christ, and for all of the departed, especially Robert Coons, Herbert Beryl, Myrtle Blow, Robert Butler, Lauren Kirkey, Mary Donahue, Mary Gardner. God of glory,
hear our prayer.
Remembering the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, blessed Stephen the Martyr, and all the saints, we offer ourselves and one another to Christ, our Savior, and to you, God of glory.
Source of all love, receive our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Keep us in the love of Christ, and bring us to the vision of his glory, through the same Christ our Savior. Amen. Please be seated. Just we do have some prayers. I didn't see any birthdays on the list. Are there any prayers on the written list?
No birthdays.
Okay. Are there any prayers? Any birthdays we're missing? Well, that's the first time in a long time we haven't had any birthdays. Well, we have two wedding and three. I think there's three wedding anniversaries. First and foremost, Deacon John and Jessica are celebrating their wedding anniversary.
We are indeed.
On the 20th.
This Thursday.
Wonderful. I remember that day. Doesn't seem all that long ago.
I can't believe it. 4 years already.
Wonderful. Well, are you doing anything special?
Oh, I think we are going to go to a little wine tasting festival.
Oh, wow. Look at fancy you. Wow.
Very good. Right here in town. We're not traveling.
Oh, not at Napa or something like that. Very good.
Well, you buy, we fly.
There you go, John.
First class, right?
Yeah.
That's wonderful. He gets to fly 30.
Yeah, clergy class, which is right behind the suitcases.
Right.
Yeah, that's great. Very good. And then Bishop Tom and Ann Ely are celebrating their wedding anniversary this week. So that is the 22nd. We'll have to do something special for them on Wednesday night when they go. They're both going to be here, so that'll be good. And then Sandy has a special wedding anniversary.
Our older son Brad and his wife Carolyn, who were married on this very day in this very place 28 years ago.
1993. And that was a Sunday, so it was a Sunday afternoon, which was
Sunday
amazing.
Afternoon.
So,
yeah.
Yep, so that is that's pretty great. So we will pray for them as well. Any other anniversaries that we should be praying for? Wonderful. Let us pray on page, let's see, now I lose it, of course. On page 7, let us pray for everybody who's having a marriage anniversary. So let us pray. O God, the giver of all that is true and lovely and gracious, grant that by your Holy Spirit, these your servants may continue to become one in heart and soul, live in fidelity and peace, and attain those eternal joys prepared for all who love you. For the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And a blessing on everybody who's having a wedding anniversary this week. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The peace of the risen Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace, everybody. Peace. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself as an offering and sacrifice to God. Prayer B can be found on page 9 in your bulletin or on page 367 in the Book of Common Prayer. Please stand as you are able.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to
thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For through your Son, Jesus Christ, you have made your church one body, even as he is one with you. And you have given us the ministry of your word, the ministry of truth, that we may proclaim your glory to the world and bring others into the joy of your everlasting kingdom. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Goodness and love, which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father,
we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be for us the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Blessed Stephen the Martyr, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your daughters and sons. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name.
Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Welcome to receive Holy Communion, and let us pray for those who cannot receive Holy Communion at this time. God of infinite mercy, we thank you for Jesus our Savior, who feeds us and gives us eternal life. We pray for those who cannot be here at this time to consume these gifts of his body and blood in this bread and wine, but we pray that they may receive the sacrament of Christ's presence, the forgiveness of sins, and all other benefits of Christ's passion. Grant that we may all continue forever in the risen life of our Savior, who with you in the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.
The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. 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 Thank you. God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son and our Savior Jesus Christ, and for showing us these holy mysteries that we are the members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal name. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. May God the Father, who has given to the Son the name above every name, strengthen you to proclaim Jesus the Christ, the Son of God.
Amen.
God the Son, our great high priest, who has passed into the heavens, clothe you with power from on high.
Amen.
God the Holy Spirit, who pours out abundant gifts upon the church, make you faithful followers of the risen Christ.
Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you now and always.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Let us now go forth in the name of the risen Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.
Four organs in one, one American, are you on objective in the French?